gospel is to be for salvation unto the ends of the earth. And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord, and as many as were ordained to eternal life believed. That is a very significant phrase. As many as were ordained to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. This is a revival that took an effect not merely on the few who believed in the synagogue on that first Sabbath day, not merely on those who believed when that gigantic meeting took place the following week, not merely on those who followed after the call from that immediate vicinity and got together and said, let's form a local church. These were people whose lives were changed. They were changed so radically that it spread throughout the entire region. Would that God would do that kind of work in our lives, so that we who have a need would suddenly be so excited about what God has done in our lives, that the word of the Lord would spread from us to our neighbors, and spread from our neighbors to their neighbors, and their relatives, and people far away, and people where they're traveling on vacation, and relatives who live in other states, and suddenly we see a great massive revival out of an entire region. That's what takes place as we look at our text here tonight. So there are several things that are very important for us to notice. Number one, the first thing we notice is that neither Paul nor Barnabas backed down or soft-pedaled their message when they got very strong opposition. That was very strong opposition. They're obviously not trying to do a popularity contest as we look at the passage, but you know, as we look at Christianity today, I think there are far too many evangelical Christians, people who claim to be evangelical, but they've got a new message, a new approach, they're soft-pedaling it, they're desperate to attain numbers, so they begin to put the central message of the gospel on the back burner and substitute entertainment for content. You go into a lot of so-called evangelical churches today, the first thing they do is they give you 35 or 45 minutes worth of entertainment with a rock band up on the stage. They call them praise and worship. Wiggling their bodies around, dressed like hippies out on the street, strumming very loud guitars, beating on very loud drums, flashing still lights in the ear of the audience, and if they cannot see, as they sway back and forth and wave their hands. That is a substitution you never find Paul or Jesus or any of the apostles doing anything like that. God did not call us to give entertainment to the crowds. He called us to give the content of the Word of God. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. It doesn't come by sad stories. It doesn't come by exciting stories. It doesn't come by all the things that people do instead of the gospel. It comes by the Word of God. And that's what we see taking place here. They're obviously not trying to retain the numbers. They had a lot of numbers. They could have said, okay, we've got the numbers now. What can we do to make the crowd happy and not make anybody unhappy? They were obviously walking a very fine line at this point because some people were starting to get very unhappy with what Paul was preaching. Not only did Paul and Barnabas not back down, as you look at that text tonight, they pushed a very known hot button and said some things that were even more offensive than what they had already said about the resurrection of Christ. What did they basically say? They said basically two different things. Number one, as they respond to the Jews who have blasphemed, they're told, look, you're lost and you're going to hell. And we find that in the phrase, but see, put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. In other words, you're lost, you're on your way to hell. The second thing they're told is, we're going to preach to the Gentiles from now on, you lost your chance. That's that phrase, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. Now, either one of those would have made their religious audience very happy. Nobody who's religious wants to be told that you're not going to make it. Nobody who is a religious Jewish audience is going to hear that the gospel is now for the Gentiles and that you guys have lost your chance at it. Now, you know, either of those things are exactly friendly things to say. It's always a scary thing here by seeing and rejected it, and they rejected the preaching of the resurrection because that was the proof that Jesus was who he said he was, and that is the proof that he can forgive sin, which is the point Paul just made. Now, Paul and Barnabas were not ignorant. They already knew the explosive reaction that would happen when they told religious Jews that God was going to save Gentiles and turn his back on the self-righteous Jews who thought they could make it on their own. You see, Paul had watched Stephen get stoned to death for just this kind of talk in Acts chapter 7. Paul was well aware of the persecution that arose after the death of Stephen because he himself was a ringleader of the ravaged Was he one of those guys who never seems to learn? Somebody who never picks up on his audience reaction as he's speaking? You know, I think that it's probably the same kind of exposure you should get if today you walked into a mosque and said something offensive about Muhammad, or if you walked into a Hindu temple and said something offensive about one of their 330 million gods. You know, something that you would obviously be putting your life on the line. And yet, because Paul knew he had the truth, he knew he had the truth based on the crucifixion of Christ and upon the resurrection, he had personally talked with the resurrected Christ. He was absolutely bold. He was totally unafraid of the message he proclaimed. Very, very clearly bold about it. It says, Paul and Barnabas waxed bold, and they said. The second thing that we notice find you prophesied crucifixion, we find you prophesied resurrection, we find you prophesied ascension to heaven. Who much is given from him shall much be required. And you and I have that all behind us. They were looking forward to it. You know it. What are you doing with it? To whom much is given, of him shall much be required. The third thing that we notice in our text tonight is the contrast between two phrases related to eternal life. Check that out if you were going through. One is in the beginning of the passage, one is in the end of the passage. The first one is in verse 46. But see, ye put it from you, and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. It's the first mention of everlasting or eternal life. But we find it mentioned once again in verses later, in verse 48. And as many as were ordained to eternal life, believe. Now this is an extremely important contrast set in the exact context with one juxtaposed against the other. Because you see, it gives us what I like to call the divine balance in the doctrine of election. The first phrase, but see, put it from you and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, shows the absolute nature of human responsibility and accountability for our choices, our actions, and the results of those actions. God does hold you accountable. There are people out there who believe in predestination and election, as we do also, but they overbalance that half of the equation. And they say to themselves, that makes me accountable. You know, if God ordained it, you know, well, what am I supposed to do about it? And so they sin and do nothing. The first phrase here, verse 46, but see, he put it from you. No, you're accountable for rejection. You've heard, and you put it from you. Let me explain what Paul says in more detail what that means. You judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life. They were actually, what they were thinking was, we judge ourselves worthy of everlasting life. He says, no, you've got it backwards. What you are doing by rejecting Christ is you are actually judging yourselves unworthy. And when you stand before God, he's going to say, you know, you've already condemned yourself. You've already judged yourself. You've already this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. They chose the fruitless stuff over the stuff that was righteous. God says, okay, that's the way you want it. Then I'll make sure that's the way you have it. That's strong. But again, we find their accountability. Who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness, they made choices. Then we find the balancing act in verse 13. Here's the human responsibility stated in Christ's cross on one hand. It doesn't matter whether it was Satan tempted you or pleasure. See, he comes from both in that passage there. How Satan, through the Antichrist, sent all this strong illusion. Then he talks about them making the choice based on the fact that they love pleasure more than they love truth. That's the flesh. But now we find another track where God is sovereign and the choice is unto salvation. Verse 13, but we are bound to give thanks only to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord. Now listen to the next phrase. Because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation. Now it's really hard to phrase that any other way. It means what it says. God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation. If you end up getting saved, it's not because you're good. If you end up getting saved, it's not because you're smart. If you end up getting saved, it's not because you're wise or because of anything in you. But God irresistibly took you as a dead man, humanly speaking, or a dead woman, humanly speaking, and he raised you in your spirit, drew you irresistibly to himself, and gave you eternal life. Because God, from the beginning, chose you for salvation. Then he explains how God does it. Through sanctification of the spirit, sanctification, you've heard me preach on that before, it deals with setting apart. Sanctifying doesn't mean holy people who walk around in covenant and robes and all these odd acts that they wear. Sanctification is what God sets us apart for himself. And he does that by the Holy Spirit of God, sanctified by the Spirit, and after God has set us apart, he irresistibly draws you to the last step, which you find here, and believe of the truth. For as we called you by our gospel, that is the means of the mechanism that he uses to draw your faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, the Bible tells us. And that's what he says in verse 14. For as we called you by our gospel to the attaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now we find it all condensed there in Paul's sermon in Acts chapter 13. Here he gives us an exposition of it and shows you that it doesn't matter what it is that tempted you to make the wrong choices. It can be the devil himself, it can be the Antichrist working miracles, or it can simply be your human pleasures, but you make the wrong choices, you are accountable. And then he explains, God is sovereign. God is the one who chooses us to salvation because we would not make that choice ourselves. sure you can give the right answer every time. The next thing that we notice is a very key quotation from the book of Isaiah. In fact, it actually comes out of two chapters in the book of Isaiah, an allusion to this. Isaiah 42:6 and Isaiah 49:6. Paul, you remember, had said that the Lord had sent them to bear a message to the Gentiles. And we find that in the statement in Isaiah 42:6. I, the Lord, have called thee to give righteousness, and will hold thy hand, and will keep thee, and give thee for a covenant of the people, for a light of the Gentiles. Now, Jesus, they read through that, probably caught for something, looked at the sin, and skipped over and read the next verse, because they didn't want anything to do with the Gentiles. But that's Isaiah the prophet. 800 years before Jesus Christ was born. Look at chapter 49, also verse 6. Both those chapters, it's verse 6, 42 and 49. Seven chapters apart. Here's Isaiah 49:6, and he said, it is a light thing that thou shouldest be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob, and to restore the preserve of Israel. I will also give thee for a light to the Gentiles, that thou mayest be my salvation unto the end of the earth. Paul says, I'm fulfilling that today, telling you about the one who is the light to the Gentiles. Telling you about the resurrected Christ, the one who died not only for our sins, but he died for the sins of the world. A light to light the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. You know where that phrase comes out? That's a quotation out of the New Testament also. That's from Luke chapter 2. Remember what's going on in Luke chapter 2? That's the chapter where Jesus is born in Bethlehem of Judea. That's the chapter where the shepherds are on the hillside, and they see the angels, glory to God in the highest, and then they find Jesus being brought into the temple for a circumcision, and two people meet him in the temple, Joseph and Mary, and baby Jesus. And one of them is Simeon, and one of them is Anna, the prophetess. And they both come to Jesus, and those are the words of Simeon. Simeon, looking at baby Jesus, quotes that passage out of Isaiah chapter 49, verse 6. Let me give you the context. Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed him. Now, can you imagine this? You go into church someplace, and some old guy who you've never seen before walks up and grabs your baby out of your arms. What would the response of most normal mothers be? Simeon is going in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is adding Simeon. The Holy Spirit is revealing things to Simeon that day. He took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, thou lettest not thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. Now here it is, verse 32. A light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed him and said unto Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign shall be spoken against. What's going on? It's called preaches Christ. There are some that fall, there are some that rise. Christ is spoken against. And that same quote that Paul is making in Acts 13 is the quotation made by Simeon in the temple over the day of Jesus. Verse 35, yea, a sword shall pierce through thine own soul also, with the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And then we find, of course, in Acts chapter 26, 13 chapters down from chapter 13 where we are. Paul preaches again that Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles. You see, this is a rather consistent message of the Apostle Paul, because it is a message based on Scripture. The prophetic scriptures of the Old Testament, we've got weeks talking about how important it is for us to understand the Old Testament prophecies, because they point to Jesus. They point to him at his first coming, or they point to him Gentiles and the glory of the people of Israel. And when they heard that, because they were so hateful of the Gentiles, they blasphemed and turned their backs on the public accountable. Oh God, that they may have sought the eternal life. As many as were given to the eternal life, believed. Verse 48 of Acts 13, we're back in the text, closing quickly here. And when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord, and as many as were given to the eternal life, believed. And the word of the Lord was published throughout all the region. When a person saved, it changes his or her life. People will say to me, I witnessed a number of people that gave me this kind of response. Oh yeah, I got saved when I was a kid. What is the question that I always like to ask them? And so how has it changed your life? Because if it doesn't change your life, you're not saved. Because the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit in your life at the moment of salvation begins a process whereby He transforms you into the image of Christ, whereby you become more